Oh, well, welcome everybody. It's great to be with you again today. And it's an amazing thing that's happening throughout the world, and God's got our attention, that's for sure. And I am so excited about what God is doing. Thanks so much for inviting us into your lounge room today. And Greg and Joanne and Nance and I want to just say a big hello. And we're just so thrilled to see that what God is doing in the hour that we're living in right now. I want to share something very, very close to my heart today, and that's about being born again. Born again. It's an amazing thing that God has done for us, and I believe one of the greatest mysteries in the Bible has to be the new birth. What God did when we got born again. It's so phenomenal, it's so dynamic and so powerful that the natural mind many times cannot conceive it, cannot really understand what happens when we somehow or other, when God comes into our life and we just stand in a spot somewhere and lift up our hearts and say, Jesus, will you come into my life? At that moment, something so dynamic and so powerful happens in a human life. And God really wants to take us into the dimension of the power, of the anointing, of the victory of the cross of Calvary. It is such an amazing thing. The new birth has to, or the born-again experience is probably the most misunderstood and yet the most important decision anyone will ever make on this planet. More than the new car, more than the house, more than even your wife or your husband, more than the color of your hair, but it's so very, very important. I cannot stress enough the dynamic power of God that comes into a person's life, that wants to take us somewhere, wants to deliver us out of and take us into something that is so powerful and unique. In Colossians chapter 1, it says, in verse 12, it says, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in the light. God has qualified me. Even though in the natural, my life was a mess, my life was lost, somehow or other, in the realm of the Spirit, and this is why God calls it a mystery. It is a mystery that it has to be spiritually discerned, that somehow or other, let me just read this to you again, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified Neil Myers to be partaker of the inheritance of the saints in the light. I can now be a partaker of everything that Jesus Christ has won for me on the cross of Calvary. When Jesus rose again triumphant over his foes, I rose with him. Today, we as Christians born again are more than conquerors. It's an amazing thing. Let me just read on here. He has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of his love, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. You see, the language of the Spirit is very, very different to natural language. Because you see, the natural language, we've got to be able to see it to be able to comprehend it. But by faith in the realm of the Spirit, we're looking into an invisible in the natural world, but we can see it in the realm of the Spirit. I pray that makes sense to us somewhere along the line here today. He is the image of the invisible God. You see, Jesus came to reveal what Jesus really looks like and what he's like and all about him. To know Jesus is to know God. To be able to see what Jesus did on this planet, that's what God does. Jesus said, I never do anything unless I see my Father do it. I only say what I hear my Father say. So we've got to understand that we're talking a totally different language here. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created that are in heaven and are on the earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principality or power, all things were created through him and for him. And he goes before all things, and to him all things consist. What an amazing statement. Jesus is our deliverer. He's delivered us from the power of darkness. Well, Jesus came to reconcile us back to God. He came to deliver me out of something that I needed to be delivered from. I don't know about you, but I needed to be delivered. I needed that King of Glory. I needed the power. I needed somebody to help me to come out of and come into that new thing. I want you to have a look with me in the book of John. John chapter 3. Amazing verses here. And it says here in verse 3, "And Jesus said to him, most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." It's an amazing thing here. Something happens when you get born again that allows you to be able to see into the realm of the Spirit. It might sound hocus-pocus to you. It might sound all wobbly-goggly. But there's something that happens in the realm of the Spirit that somehow or other allows us, as when we get born again, this born-again experience now awakens something on the inside of us. Something clicks in that now we can hear and we can see. As we read the Word of God, the Word of God becomes alive to us. The Word of God begins to speak to us. God begins to reveal the mysteries to us. He starts to show us answers. He starts to reveal stuff to us that we really didn't know before. When I first got saved, I didn't know very much at all, but I was only born again for a little while. But God started to speak to me about water baptism. And I, you know, when I started talking about that, I talked to different people there, educated people, people that knew the Word of God. And I talked about, because of the denomination that I was involved in, they didn't believe in believer's baptism. They had an infant baptism. So now there's a conflict because the Spirit of God speaking to me, man speaking to me. And so, I went first of all and I said about this, and they said, "Oh, were you sprinkled as a baby?" I said, "Yes, I was." And they said, "Well, you don't need anything else. You're okay." And I said, "Well, thank you very much for that information." And I was quite happy with that. But as I began to read the Word again, it just kept on coming, kept on coming. Then I opened up the Kellogg's Corn Flakes packet and I looked and it said, "Sprinkle with sugar, but immerse in milk." So I found out that there was a difference between sprinkling and being immersed. Now, that's a bit of a joke. I'm sorry about that. But it's real. We need, you know, to hear from God, and God will speak to us. God will reveal stuff to us. "Most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom." The kingdom of God, our spiritual eyes are opened. This has to be a work of the Spirit. You know, many of us Christians get stuck in the birthing channel. When we get born again, God wants to take us out of and take us into. My parents told me that when I got, when I was a baby being born in the natural, I didn't want to get born. And they had to put forceps on my head and pull me out because I didn't want to come out into the world. I didn't want to go there. I wanted to stay where I was. It was comfortable. It was warm. Everything was good. I didn't want to get born, but they put these bloody forceps on my head and dragged me out. And there I was, born. So there's a lot of things. You see, God wants to take us out of the world, the world system, the world pull, sin. I don't know about you, but I found it very, very easy to sin. Did you find it? I didn't find any difficulty whatsoever in sin. I found it very, very easy. And you start hearing things. And I really like the Old Testament where it said an eye for an eye. But then I heard about, you know, you got to turn the other cheek. I wanted to pull that page out of my Bible. You see, the flesh gets around your life and you're comfortable in there and you want to just stay in that flesh area and just continue the way you were and sort of get a ticket to heaven. But it's more than that, isn't it? It's a lot more than that. So we've just got to realize here that there's a work of the Spirit. Many of us are still, you know, I know some Christians that have been saved 40 years and they're still in the birthing canal. They still haven't really come out. But you see, what God wants to do is He wants to take you out of that so you can grow and so you can develop and so you can experience everything that He's won for us. You know, we get stuck there. The new birth is not just getting to heaven. It's just not a ticket to heaven. It's totally the deliverance from one kingdom into another kingdom. From death to life, the new birth takes us from the natural man's ability to God's supernatural ability. In Romans 5, let's have a look at Romans chapter 5. Amazing scriptures here. Very, very real. Romans chapter 5, and I'm just going to read from verse 12. It says, therefore, just as through one man's sin entered the world, one man caused sin to enter the world, and death through sin, and thus death spread to all men, because all men sinned. That is very hard to comprehend. We can say, well, I didn't deserve it. No, you didn't. You didn't. But it happened all the same. There's a lot of things in life that we might not have deserved, but they happened. And if we just continue in that attitude, well, I didn't deserve it, and so you do nothing about it. But what you can do is you can reach out to the answer, because the answer is more real. One man's offense, death spread to all men. All humans died because of that. Verse 17, it says, For if by one man's offense death reigned through the one, much more, everybody say much more, those who receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness will reign in life through the one, Jesus Christ. Therefore, as through one man's offense, judgment came to all men, resulting in condemnation, even so, through one man's righteous act, the free gift came to all men, resulting in justification of life. Justification. For as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners, so also by one man's obedience many were made righteous. I think we just should stop there right now and give the Lord a thank you. Thank you. I didn't deserve it. I didn't deserve the sin. I didn't deserve to be delivered. I was living a life of sin, but I thank God if I was the only man alive, He still would have died for me, and I'm so thankful for that. We should just give Him the praise, amen. Give Him all the praise. We went from death to life. We should, you know, just give Him worship and praise. Many times just think about that and give Him thanks. You see, where there was no way, God made a way. Where there was no hope, God gave us hope. His grace is sufficient. The new birth opens a supernatural power. I believe that God wants to reveal Himself to us. God wants to show Himself strong. So our faith wouldn't be in our ability, but it would be in God's ability. I want you to have a quick look with me, if you would, in the book of Ephesians. This is one of my favorite books. I love Ephesians so much. It speaks to me and it encourages me and it challenges me and it causes me to start to stand and start to draw on the power of God and draw on the anointing. Today we've got some instruments here. We've got a PA system. We've got a TV camera. And they're all there on their own. They couldn't do it, but they're drawing from a power source. They're drawing power into it that makes it operate, that makes it work today. And that's why you can see me, and I pray that you can hear me. But anyhow, that's another story. It says here, it says in verse 17, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him. This is where it comes good. The eyes of your understanding. Not your natural eyes. But somehow or other, when you get born again, this other part of you comes alive. And you begin to be able to see. And this is their prayer. They want the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. They want somehow or other for this part of us to come alive so that we can be able to comprehend with all the saints, comprehend what God has done for us. The dynamic power, the anointing, the victory, oh my God, it's life, and it's just amazing, it's amazing, it's amazing. May he give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation of the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened or opened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling and what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power towards us who believe. Do you believe today? There's an exceeding greatness of power that's been poured out upon you today. It's coming into you today. It's going towards you today. Those that believe according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in heavenly places, far, far above principalities and powers and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him to be head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that fills all in all. Amen. And you, Neil Myers, he made alive, who were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience. Friend, I want to tell you, I found it very, very easy to sin. I found it very, very easy to not turn the other cheek. But I want to tell you now, God comes and he wants to touch our life in a special way. God made a way where there was no way. The children of Israel, I'm not going to read all this stuff to you, but you can read it. You know these stories only too well. That they came to a Red Sea. They had no way of escape. There was an army coming after them. But God destroyed an army of fully trained warriors as he closed the Red Sea over them. God's people had no weapons in the natural against this great army. See, what we've got under the mystery is there that there's, if God be for me, who can be against me? The mystery is today that we are surrounded by the angels of God, the power of God. The mystery today is that God has filled us with a power that came from heaven. We are filled with power. We are filled to overflowing with power. And if we can just start to realize that, and the anointing and God working for us, the power of God, man, it's just so awesome to be able to just draw on that power, draw on that anointing, and know that it's there. God's people had no weapons in the natural against his army. But the Bible says, it says, no weapon formed against us can prosper. Every tongue that rises against you in judgment, you can condemn, you can pull down. You've got to speak to the mountains that are around our life. Every tongue that rises against us, we can condemn them, we can pull them down. Speak to the mountain, your life. Drive them back. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down imaginations and thoughts and everything that tries to exalt itself above the knowledge of God. There are things that get around our lives. We hear this and we hear that, and today we're living in this. So many different thoughts about coronavirus and this and who did it, who didn't do it, and goodness knows what. And we get clouded with this. But we've got to pull down those imaginations, and we've got to pull down those wrong thoughts. Every tongue that rises against it in judgment, we can condemn. Amen? We've got to be able to do it. We've got to let the power of God come. That's what God says. We can speak to the mountains in our life and drive them back. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 10 verse 3, it says, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God for pulling down strongholds, casting down every imagination and every thought and everything that tries to exalt itself above the knowledge of God. That we're living in a time where there's so many things that are going on about coronavirus. We don't know whether we're coming or going. We don't know who created it. We don't know what. All I know is that God before me, who can be against me? And I want to say this there, that there are so many thoughts and so many different things coming at us that we really need to cast down those things that are trying to be above the knowledge of God, what God says to us. Amen. Christians accept and tolerate what the enemy is doing. In John 10, it says Satan comes to rob, to kill, and destroy. But it says that I have come that you might have life and you might have it more abundantly. Abundantly means more than enough. It means plentiful, plentiful. God has come and He has given us His Word, and His Word is very, very real. And I want to read a psalm to you today. It's a beautiful psalm, and it's found at Psalm 103. And this is what it says. It says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all His benefits. That is so very, very important. We forget. We forget. That's why Jesus says in communion, do this in remembrance of me. I want you to know what I've done for you. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Friend, I would rather go down blessing God than try to work it out and try to be miserable and try to blame God. I want to tell you, my God is an awesome God. He is a powerful God. He has made everything available to me. The enemy comes to rob, to kill, and destroy, but Jesus came to give me life and to give it to me more abundantly. I love this more abundant life. Amen. I love the joy of the Lord. The joy of the Lord is your strength. It's powerful. It's amazing. Let me just read it again. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name. Church, I can hardly wait to get together again and come together and lift up our hands. I don't know. I feel like I want to run the building now. I just want to come together and all that is within me, just with you guys, and just to worship God again and hear the sound of praise going up. And oh man, it's so exciting. Cool. I'm a little bit of a fanatic, but I just love to worship. All that is within me, bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all of His benefits. Forget all the, we forget the benefits. Look at the benefits. It forgives your iniquities. It heals your diseases. It redeems your life from destruction. It crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies. It satisfies your mouth with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. I believe that with every fiber of my being. Amen. See, when the King of Glory comes in, who is this King of Glory? He is the Lord, strong and mighty and powerful in battle. He will battle. He will win. He will fight for you in Jesus' name. Amen. Christians, don't accept, don't tolerate what the enemy is trying to do in your life. Do not accept it. Stand up. The enemy comes to rob, to kill, and destroy. Greg was preaching the other day how the disciples had forgotten to take bread. And he shared it so well there about you know, really, he said there that they'd forgotten, really, not necessarily the bread, but they'd forgotten who was with them. They'd forgotten how Jesus had fed the 5,000 just early. That piece of bread could have even been a bit of the leftovers from feeding the 5,000. It could have been the anointed bread, amen. But all I know is that many times we forget the benefits. They forget Jesus was with them. We forget what the Word says. The Word encourages us in Psalm 103 not to forget His benefits. The benefits of being born again. I was delivered out of one kingdom and I was brought into another kingdom. I was delivered. I was set free. He forgave me all of my sin. He heals my body. He redeems my life from destruction. Man, I know I was on a course of destruction. I was going on a collision course with destruction. Marriage was falling apart. Sickness in the family. Despair, brokenness, hurt. But I praise God that not very long after that, Jesus came into our lives. Both Nancy and I got born again. And Jesus came in. He touched us. He redeemed us. He satisfied us. He redeemed my life from destruction. He crowns me with loving kindness. He satisfies my mouth with good things. He renews my strength. Start to claim all that Jesus has done for you. See, there's some things there that we might have to go back to. Joshua had to take the people of God back to a place where they'd heard about the giants, Hebron. He had to go back there, and he had to go and destroy some things because, you see, that was the area where they'd come to, where they'd turned around, and they started to walk away. They forgot the promise. They forgot what God said, and they began to walk away, and they wandered around in the wilderness for 40-odd years. And after that 40 years, he comes back. He comes back to that thing, and he said, I've got to take you out. I'm going to take you out. And he had to take those giants out. And what that did was brought a release. See, there's a lot of things that hold us bound. We've got to find that release. That's in Joshua 11, 21 through to 22. Then in Numbers 13 to 22, it says there, this is a story where early in the piece where they came there and they'd seen all these things. They said, truly, everything that God says was true. It was a land flowing with milk and honey. Oh, but there was giants, there was walled cities, there was this, there was that. You see, you've got to come back. Joshua had to come back to the place, Hebron, and take out that which stopped him from going where he was going, that stopped him from going into the promises. You see, there's a lot of things that stop us from going into the promises. I said before that we get caught up in the birthing channel. We get caught up in there and we never ever come out into it. We never really trust God. We never really put our faith in God. We never put our faith really in the Word of God. Yes, yes, I know that you can say, Neil, but I'm talking real here. I'm talking about people we need to go in and we need to break down some things. You can't sidetrack some of these things. You can't pretend things didn't happen. Sometimes it might be to apologize. Sometimes it might be to forgive. And, you know, to forgive. I can remember there when in the days of old, when there was a few guys there, they got a bit cranky with me. One of the blokes says, if he ever sees you again, he's going to take you out. And I said, could we make an appointment? I want to see him. Can we make an appointment? Because I want to tell you, that guy would have taken me out, man. He would have whipped me. He would have whipped me, but I'd heard how a Chihuahua dog had killed a German shepherd. You see, I heard that a Chihuahua dog had killed a German shepherd. You see, the German shepherd choked on him while he was trying to swallow him. Another joke. I hope you understand that. I love dogs. I love German shepherds. I love them all. But you see, we've got to realize there that you know, that adrenaline got inside me and unforgiveness, and I would have had a go, but I want to tell you, he would have wiped me out. He would have wiped me out. But it's only the Spirit of God. And it was interesting because we did make the appointment and he did come and see me. And as he sat with me and as we talked and as we shared the power of God, that mystery, the invisible anointing of God, and within 10 or 15 minutes, a man was crying and putting his arms around me and asking me to forgive him, and I was asking him to forgive me and blah, blah, blah. Because you see, there's somebody greater than you and me. The power of anointing is more powerful. And God wants to show us that we can put our trust in Him. No matter what goes on, we can win. I want you to have a look at 2 Corinthians with me, if you will, quickly. And I'm on about my second or third closing, Greg. I learned that from you already. Some bad habits from Greg. It says verse 16, 2 Corinthians 4:16. It says, therefore we do not lose heart, even though our outward man is perishing, yet there is an inward man is being renewed day by day. You see, this inward man is the one that comes alive when you get born again and makes all the promises of God available. God starts to speak to us. It says, for our light afflictions, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory, while we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Again, let me say it. It might sound like wobbly-gook to you. It might sound strange, but that's the truth. That's the reality. That's the truth. Sometimes we've got to go back to Hebron and face the mountains that caused us to back away. It may be a mountain that's very, very real. And oh man, you can feel it. A mountain of divorce, a mountain of financial ruin, mountain of sickness, rejection, rape, abortion, adultery, lust, jealousy, loss. We've got to go back and revisit some of these places, some of these mountains. Those things that made us turn back. I know I'm talking to some pastors, ex-pastors, people there, Christians that have fallen in love with God. You had a great passion, you had dreams, you had purpose, you had everything. But things, something like that, it might have been divorce, it might have been financial ruin, it might have been sickness, it might have been rejection. I don't know. Man, rejection is a horrible thing. Whoever said sticks and bones may break your bones, but names will never hurt you. I don't know where he got that from, but that is the greatest lie that humanity can ever have. Because I want to tell you, words will hurt you more than anything else. Rejection will hurt you. Rejection will stop you. But you've got to rise up. You've got to go back and face that mountain. You've got to say, I'm more than a conqueror. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You've got to revisit the place, the mountain, the giant, where we turn back. You've got to go back, face it with the supernatural power of God. Bring it down. Speak to it. Remember the woman in the war room? Her whole life was being turned upside down, and she had a revelation from God, and she stood her ground, and she said, "Listen here, devil, I know you can hear me, but I want to tell you something right now. This family is under new management. Jesus is in control. You are being evicted. Now get out." Now that's how I'm telling it what's said. And I often do things like that. I often do stuff like that because I believe it's very, very, very important. Joshua, not only a giant killer, but he was a giant eradicator. He didn't just face the giants, he utterly expelled them and destroyed their cities. Joshua led his army like a giant thrashing machine. I believe that Jesus wants to raise up people who will do the same. The sleeping giant called the church is awakened by the fire. It begins to rise, being awakened. Friend, I want to tell you right now, as I've been sharing, I can feel a fresh wind of the Spirit starting to blow over my life. Blow over you, I pray today. There's something there, there's an excitement that's beginning to stir. There's something there that we've got to break strongholds. We've got to push things down. You know, it's what you say. And you know, when we're doing that, I don't know about you, but we can make excuses. I know what it's like to be an excuser. I used to make the greatest excuses you could ever. Why I couldn't. Why I shouldn't. Why I didn't. Now, those answers are not worth tuppence up in heaven. You might say, Joshua was a great warrior. Who am I to speak to mountains? You see, you've got to realize that Joshua was born into a family of slaves. He was born into a family of slaves. He and his family were totally controlled by a ruthless, fierce mob of taskmasters. He would have seen his father and others beaten and driven by these taskmasters as the workload became so heavy that they begin to stumble and get weary and faint. You see, this was his future. They'd been like this for 400 years. Generation after generation were born and died in this horrible existence. Somehow or other, I don't know, but all I know is the power of God is always working. And I know today, without any shadow of doubt, that the power of God is working all over the world, ready to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we could ever imagine or think. He's about to blow our minds. I guess as he watched and listened, he would hear some of the older men start to talk about the days of old, the days of freedom, the days of liberty, the days of God just protecting him and loving them and watching over them and everything that he was. They would have said, you know, trust the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding, but in every way acknowledge him and he will direct your path. And somehow or other, in Joshua's heart, I believe something would have been stirring. That wind that I was talking about a little while ago, it was blowing then, and it's blowing again today. And as it would have begun to blow over him, and that spirit inside him would have begun to start to listen and reveal, and somehow or other, hope would have started to come inside him. One day there, as he was working out there, as the taskmasters most surely might have even put the whip into his back and abused him and shouted at him and called him all kinds of names. But somehow or other, as he looked up even from the ashes, as he looked up, he saw an old man with an old beard starting to walk towards him. And that was old Moses. Moses coming back to where he had turned away, coming back to that place, coming back with a message of hope, coming back with a victory. And his voice was saying this: God said, set my people free and let them go. Hallelujah. He had a message, and somehow or other, when Joshua would have heard that message, as he began to work in that task force, he started to grow and develop. Praise God, I'm flexing something here, and I don't know what I'm flexing. Oh, praise God. You see, he started to grow strong in his God and strong in that. And he started to follow after Moses and he became one of Moses' champions. You see, he had a mission. Moses had a mission. God said, set my people free. I believe the work of the church is right where a lot of the church is right now. They're just sitting back idly waiting for the rapture. Waiting for the rapture to come. Get me out of here. Get me out of this mess. Oh, no. No, I want to tell you, friends, that is not the vision. That is not the dream. We've been born again with the power of God, born again with the anointing, the power that wants to come all over us and touch us. Friend, today, if you are here listening to me, then you might have even gone back. You might have gone away because of something, some hurt, disappointment. You might even have your own set of circumstances that have affected your life, that have somehow or other caused you to put this book down, put it over on a shelf somewhere, the vision, the dream, the purpose, the plan that God had for your life, and you've put it over there on another shelf, and you're sitting around, I don't know what you're doing. You may be just waiting for the rapture. You may not even have that faith in God anymore. You may have just drifted so far away. The Bible tells us in Hebrews that we're going to take the more earnest heed to the things that we've heard, lest we drift away. How shall we escape, the Bible says, if we neglect so great a salvation? We can neglect what God has done. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, and forget not all of his benefits. Friend, I'm not selling steak knives. I'm not trying to sell something here, but I'm telling you that there's more than enough in Jesus Christ today to touch your life and to lift you up out of the miry clay, take you out of the ashes, out of the hurt, out of the disappointment, out of the brokenness, pour his spirit back in you again and fill you with power, fill you with vision, fill you with life, that you'll go out there and kick devil butt, amen, in Jesus' name. If you don't know Jesus and you think, you know, well, what's this guy really talking about? Well, I want to tell you, friend, it's better felt than telt. It's better, you will never, without being born again, you cannot even understand the kingdom of God. I want to encourage you today, if you don't know Jesus, ask him to come into your life. Ask him to come in. Jesus, would you reveal yourself to me today? Would you help me today? Would you come into my life? I want to be born again. I want to know you, but Lord, I just don't want to sit back idly now and just sitting around waiting for something. I want to be part of this army. I want to be part of this end time army. I want to prophesy this right now. I want to tell you there's some people that right now that you're not saved yet, but and you might not even be listening to me, but there are people that are not saved yet that are going to be saved. They're going to rise up. They're going to become part of the kingdom. They're going to become warriors. They're going to become, I don't know, just they're just going to do amazing things because God is going to build an army. Friend, I want to tell you that if we're old and we've lost our passion, lost our dream, don't get angry with God because God wants to use you more than you could ever imagine or think. But if you keep resisting Him, if you keep pushing Him back, if you keep saying, no, 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 I want to tell you, God's going to raise up another generation. He's going to raise up another people because truly as I live, God says, all the earth is filled with my glory. And Jesus said, in the last days, I'm going to pour out of my Spirit on all flesh, on the just and on the unjust. And I want to tell you today, I'm hungry, I'm thirsty, I haven't got an umbrella on, I'm just hungry. I want the rain of God to rain on me. I want to be filled again with the power of God. I want to make my last days mean something. I want to be part of this end time revival. Oh, friend, you can be born again today. You can be filled with the power of God. Vision can come back into your life again if you've lost your vision, you've lost your dream. Oh, would you please come back? There's a man by the name of Graham, and you're watching right now, and you've got extreme back pain. You've got extreme back, not just a little back pain, you've got extreme back pain. And there's a lot of others here. If you want to come into agreement with me right now, you might have back pain as well, and you can have what Graham's going to get right now. Father, in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I lift Graham to you, and I break the power, I break its power in Jesus' name over his life. Back, come into line, be healed right now. In Jesus' name. Father, we give you all the praise. Father, we thank you today for touching people's lives. We ask you, Lord, today, by your Spirit, just to pour it out upon us. We're hungry. We're thirsty. We want you. We want you. We want you. We don't want religion. We want you. We want your reality. Touch us with your reality today. Friend, if wherever you are, why don't you just lift up your hands right now? Say, Jesus, come and touch us afresh. Pour out your Spirit again upon us. Help us, Father, and we'll give you all the praise, we'll give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Thank you so much. Thanks, Greg and Joanne, for today, and you be blessed. We're looking forward to you guys coming back. Please come quickly. Now, that's Jesus, but you can come too, eh? And we're looking forward to enjoying our times together and watch God do whatever he's got to do. Love you guys. Bless your church. Amen.